Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the Nexon Sponsorship League, coming to you from the joinDOTA studios. We, of course, are your English option for covering your live stream here from the Korean tournament, where there is a lot of money up for grabs. I think it's actually 96,000 USD in total prize pool for this competition. We are here for game number two of our winners bracket semi-final with MVP going up against FXO. And let's actually go, you know what, straight into the game. Let's go straight into the game. So, draft time already up and running now. So, we'll have MVP over on the Dire side for this matchup. And over on the Radiant side, it'll be FXO taking up their position over there. Of course, these guys, after game number one, FXO is going to be feeling very, very confident about life, universe, and everything. While MVP, like, they're not going to feel too great after that first game. They had the advantage in the early start for the lanes, and then that aggressive tri-lane turned into a quad lane, turned into first blood going against them, turned into all hell breaking loose, basically. But this time around, MVP at least know they won't have to deal with both the Venomancer and the Bounty Hunter. So they directly ban up against FXO on that one. And now FXO, they go Visage and Nature's Prophet. So we go down a different line here. Now they're the ones with a Visage. I only said Visage just then because I saw a guy posting last night saying that it's great that Loda finally is here on the live stream pronouncing the Visage name properly as Visage. And it's like, no, at the same time, he actually said Visage. We all say it. It's like we say Abaddon instead of Abaddon. It's just our thing, people. I would call it a European thing, but I'm from Australia. But I've always known Visage as Visage. So anyway, Pugnar as well as Batrider now are going to be banned out too. We take out the Puck and the Storm Spirit. So banning up against the mid lane solos, up against MVP. With those two ban ups, I'm already feeling that we're looking at, a Queen of Pain was the first one which came to mind for this. For FXO, the first thing that came to mind with their lineup is the fact that Lifestealer hasn't been banned up just yet. Would be a very obvious pickup for them. It can run very aggressive on their tri lane. You go Naga, Visage, plus the Lifestealer up there. Reserved. It's a good hero for jumping in, or good hero to actually piggyback as well onto the back of that Nature's Prophet as he goes around the map. Doom. And MVP, they're going to go with one of, one of the most powerful heroes in the current game, the Doombringer pickup. He can go so many different options. Middle solo, can go safe lane, full farmer, can go straight up jungler as well. And then you want to add a different lineup. You can also think about Doom and Lich. Lich is already one of the best laners out there. With his recent rework, he is one of the best laners out there. And with the clockwork, though, the lane's starting to get a little bit crowded on the off lane. Because you got your clockwork that's looking for fun. You could run him as a mid solo. I got a funny feeling, though, that MVP are going to look at this Lich and take him as a core support. Which, for me, in a dual lane, that's kind of okay. But you still want to get the quick levels up on him. I was a big fan of the days when Lich was run, it was even before the recent changes in Lich, was run on an off lane and was just left solo. You get an insanely fast level 6. There's going to be a lot of damage coming out very early on. And that ultimate with a large amount of bounces that you get from it, you get one teamfight controller with that lineup and just go make some pain. That's what it's all about. DK is going to be the fourth pickup here from FXO. So that gives us our mid solo, the Dragon Knight. Nature's Prophet for the bottom lane. That still leaves the Lifestealer option for the aggressive tri lane. I'm wondering if Febby's got something else up his mind for this. Hunji's going to be the last, going to be picking up the last one right now. I still want to see how he wants to lane this. I really see how he wants to lane this. It is not going to be a simple decision for him. Because I don't know if they know about like the possibility of running Clockwork as a support. Because KSI did a lot. That was obviously from the CIS scene, though. So you can run a Clockwork support, but you've really got to be very active. And you've got to be a roaming ganking kind of combination. Kings. And, he was banned out in the last game. He was banned out in the last game. He's going to slip through. in this game, I say slip. He's not really a hero. He's like, oh, you gotta watch out for that Klinks. Klinks is always played, peoples. Always, I say, Klinks will be played.
10 seconds remaining.
But it must be a signature thing, because FXO banned this out in the last game. Look at him. Like, look at him. Okay. Okay. Klinks, right? Okay.
Reserve cool. Time.
Not a problem at all. Not a problem at all. Yes. We can handle a Klinks, can't we?
Yeah.
Doom and a Klinks. You give a Shadow Blade, an only Shadow Blade to that Doombringer and have him running across the map and then try and initiate. Maybe. There you go, your Nyx and your Gyro out of the pool.
Radiant team pick.
So Gyro, it can be sad he doesn't get to be played, but at the same time, in this lineup from FX, so I'm kind of happy that we're not going to see a Gyro. Obviously, with the DK Dragon form, we've already got a decent element of team fight from that. That's if he can get into it. Gotta be very mindful of what that Doom is gonna do to you. And maybe that's also the other reason why we don't see the Lifestealer coming off here from FXO. Because Doom, obviously, a great, fantastic counter up against the Doom, up against the Lifestealer. Just removing that ability to Life Leech during the fight.
Remaining.
The issue is, though, if you try other heroes that, like, still require, abilities to
reserve
fight,
time.
You're basically toast. So you can go for a straight right clicker here from FXO. That's their other option. A ranged DPSer that can just destroy. Doesn't matter if Doom comes in close. Because he might silence up things like that Feast, but if you got the DPS, you just stand your ground up against him. But then you can't go too fragile, because then Klinks will start to hunt you. And Clockwork and Hookshot in too once he gets Klinks doing a bit of scout work for him. Or if that Orchid comes up, and you won't have any of your abilities as well. So you basically have a double silence coming out from MVP. But Febby's got the choice to make right now. I'm always feeling a Dread Ranger in this. But we get Pudge. Well,
team pick.
If you can't DPS him, tank him, peoples. Just tank him. That's one way to approach this. FXO wants to have a little bit of fun with this game. And MVP, with the Pudge pick up against them, heroes like Lich are going to be very, very scared. But this also throws a bit of a spanner in the works for the laning, I was thinking. Because this now, like,
remaining.
Pudge is normally a solo mid. There's very, very rare times when you'll
Five
see a Pudge go
remaining.
For a solo lane. In fact, I believe Dendi is the only one that really does it. And normally he'll have a decent amount of farm before he even comes out of the lane. And they just farm him up, and then it's non-stop roaming then. You don't go back to a lane at that point. You get your basic items up and running, and then you just roll with the Pudge. But MVP's got one last choice now. Pudge a hero, which he breaks lines. That's really that's the biggest strength of Pudge. Pudge is a hero that you can have an entire team in a perfect line, a push lineup, and then a hook comes in and one of you gets dragged away. And then the rest of your team is like, well, do we save our teammate? Or do we go in? And Ricky Maru, MVP, go for the base right-click DPS, which I kind of thought that maybe we would see out from FXO. But in this case, it's in the hands of Banhua. And that does mean that, well, yeah. Let's see how it all does unfold. But it should be a support Doombringer. Kaiser played the Earthshaker in the last game. So it may just be a jungle Doom. It's probably just going to be a jungle Doom. Which will push the Ricky to the safe lane for MVP. Babysat by possibly Lich. Klinks to off lane. And then Clockwork for the middle lane. And that could be the assumption right now. At the same time, yeah, Banhua's going to, yeah, he wants the safe lane. The middle lane solo before was, well, somebody else. Let's get ourselves into the game, peoples. Let's get ourselves into the game. Game number two, FXO going up against MVP is what we're into right now. It's the winner's bracket semifinal. There is a lot at stake for this. There is a lot at stake. A lot of money coming out for the Nexon Sponsorship League for this first season. In fact, I'm just checking that right now. I'm not even quite sure how to even say that number. I'll have to check my secondary. My secondary thing. It's $89,000. 10 million won is what it is. So it's $89,000 is the prize pool for this first season. It looks like FXO will also be sending Pudge. Well, you know how we talked about Pudge is normally a middle lane solo. Sometimes he goes safe lane. It seems in this game, he's going to go aggressive lane. And they're all coming into the Dire side. I say all. It's the whole tri lane coming into the Dire side jungle. You know what? It's Pudge. He's chasing the monies. We've got to go back to the golden treasures, peoples. Middle lane solo will be the DK. And then they just drop on the bottom. So at least I was right about everything apart from... Well, I was right about every single lane that the Pudge came in. I thought it was going to mix it up. But it doesn't seem like FXO are going to change from their desires. They still run their last hero pickup up on the top lane. And now they look for a kill. Ensnare. Febby. He's gone rot first level. The Frost going to keep him away. Grave Chill going down right now from the Visage. Ricky Maru, he's got Blink available, and that's the only thing. And, well, Pudge had to go through a lot of his life points when he just did the rot, as well as take the damage from the creep wave. And they'll pull that one down. Looks like Visage trying to be a little bit more of a nuisance to this Doombringer. Looking for a hero, a creep to devour, but he can't do it. The movement that came out from the Radiant side meant that, well, one, his big camp was blocked up, but two, actually, these other ones didn't spawn up. Observer Ward's going to get dewarded out. His camps will now spawn at least on one side. the ultimate piss off. Mud Golems. And then he gets an Ogre Frostmage. I shouldn't laugh at someone's dismay. But it's just so funny. It's just so funny. Oh, Doombringer. One of the best junglers in the game. But rather dependent on still getting some good creeps out. This Klinx is not having a great time on bottom lane. This is now the power that you get from an Aegis Prophet. Also, greetings to Nahaz. Nahaz has now joined us. Yeah. But this bottom lane is not the funnest lane in the world for a Klinx. It's a matchup where you've got to be very, very precise with it. You watch a player like Funnik. Like, if you can find an old replay of Funnik playing up against a Aegis Prophet and Funnik playing the role as the Klinx, you'll see how you play up against it. You're basically going to get rid of these trees as quickly as possible. That's the primary objective when you do this. Harassment directly towards the hero is great, but you're going to burn through your mana pool. And what in the meantime, these trees that get created, they just keep lowering your life points. We're going to get ourselves a first hook up on the top lane, and then into the rot. That's going to be low life, though, for the Pudge to run back himself away from Mafia. He could have just stuck around and kept that rot going, but he backs off the salvo popper from the Ricky Maru as well. I think they're a little bit too concerned about how much damage they're going to take from this creep wave. And with a blink down, Banwa, you know he wants it. Oh, he turned around! The salve went, and it means first blood goes the way of Mafia. MVP are off to a good start. And FXO. Moments. And they're going to lose another one. For some reason, Nature's Prophet ran all the way up to the tier 2 tower in the mid. And Kaiser said, screw my own jungle. I'm going to go to the enemy jungle. Run a bottle. Corey, however, now it's 3 minutes. It can start flying now. The only lane which I say is, well, it's actually not, it's not even going right for FXO. Hoonji's 13-3 up on this clockwork up against a 12-1, so it's a level matchup. Pudge managed to find 9 CS up on this top lane up against a Ricky Maru 6-1, but you still gave away first blood. And the only reason why I'm also rather skeptical about this top lane is, one, because we have a just proper dying in the bottom lane. It's a nice little early level of strafe. So Klinx now to just roll with the punches. Hook available. And waft. Blinks up towards the Lich. And it'll stay close up to Ricky Maru. This time Pudge does commit to it. And it's confidence in himself to make sure he can keep that rock going. But that's going to be one of those decisions from the Pudge where he's like, I could have stuck around, just got the rock, got the kill on the Rikimaru before he blinked away and then used his salve and then tried to come back into the fight again. Because all of that just bought Lich time. We got a smoke movement coming towards the mid, hearing the cogs go off at the same time. So March as well as Hunji locked in together. The DK with a stun. He's got three levels breathe fire. This is his kill. This is his kill. Doesn't even need the support to rotate in from the Pudge, but Pudge is still going to move down. Oh, wait. It's a level 2 hook. Klink's just TP'd in. I don't know if they... Oh, and the ensnare. He's still got enough damage, but he wasn't ready for the rot. It's a point-blank range hook, and this will be the death of the Klink's. It's a 2-kill streak, which Pudge is able to take. Rikimaru now going to come in. Look for the timing on that rot denial, but then Rikimaru, he couldn't turn his back to him. By turning his back, the level 2 backstab kicked in, which means he could push him. If he attacked him head-on, he would have brought him in range of a denial. He could have just rotted himself to death just then. Because he turned his back, he gave the option to the Rikimaru just one-hit him. More TP's coming to the middle lane. A little bit more delayed for the Pudge this time around. He's up to a level 3 hook. If he's able to latch the Rikimaru, what is that vision? He is... Oh, yeah, I'm pretty sure he can see him. Vanhoa's just moved back a little bit further. Doombringer. Well, he's going to get spotted out by the Nature's Prophet. It's like, guys, do we forget about him? He's walking around the side of our jungle right now. But he's out of bottle charges. Actually out of a lot of things. Middle lane, they're diving. Blink up. DK stun. Range for the hook. Oh, that was just off the side. They're going to split themselves up. Hunji, he's got hook shot. With the rocket, he'll scout it out. There is no ultimate up here by Pudge, and it won't help him out anyway. Time for Rot, he's gonna hook in, use the stick charges, and then Rot, he gets the kill! At the same time, Lich ends up dying on the top lane. Fereb's coming in to get this one hit into Pudge to pick him up, but it's not gonna work. Pudge is long, long gone. And March uses bottle charges and then pick up a haste rune too. So now FXO start to bring back a little bit of what they lost. Some good movement of Pudge and just that intimidation factor working nicely. And then to get a kill up on this top lane as you've... We now have an off-lane dual lane of supports. Visage as well as the Naga Siren together. Funny enough, both these heroes at one time were actually considered to be hard carries. Or semi-carries, I should say. Because they weren't hard carries, they were semi-carries. Visage, though, for him, that's dating back to about 2009, 2010. If you want to remember when he was back as a carry. For Naga Siren, it's not dating back that far. You're going back maybe 6-9 months for her. Pudge smoke movement again. He's got boots and urn available, so definitely going to be looking for those kills. At the same time, you got movement coming out from MVP. So they got Doombringer back down towards the bottom lane. The clockwork, he has managed to find level 6 down here, but NSCS is continued slowly. My Prophet also found his own CS. Grave Chill, Ensnare, Familiars, just drop them. Down they go. Lichon is going to go down. It's not going to bounce again. And one more attack as this Naga Siren. Rikimaru, he can't blink. Oh, he's trying to next level him. TP out the tree line. Vanua won't find him. He tried to next level him by sending one illusion away and then leaving the two of them together. And the Rikimaru, well... It's not the fact that he didn't fall for it, he never even got an attack off. There's those micro skills. I had a quick chat to Notel too, while Fnatic guys are over there in Korea. Whoops, there goes Visage. That lasted long. Is DK gonna look for a revenge kill? In Dragon form with the stun and with the 4 points breathe fire. Vorm. No mana. Oh, he's got three for the Invis. But they needed that Prophet Ollie to bounce a little bit earlier. Now on bottom lane, Clockwork is actually going to latch into the Prophet, who already just threw out that ultimate. At the same time, Pudge coming in through the rear. The Sprout keeps him away! He keeps him away! Doombringer's going to get dismembered up. Clockwork has to walk the long way because the Rot was going to kill him off anyway. And the Familiar's coming to finish off the end! Oh, Nature's Prophet! Get over here! Manages to get the consolation prize as well! Stealing the knife set! Or the free board game from Mattel, from MVP. And 10-6 now on the board. Wonderful Sprout. Absolutely superb Sprout coming out there from Ranto. You thought he was a goner. And now the push of the bottom lane. Pudge has two earn charges. You got Forever that came down here. Febby have a blinder. He's not going to try it. His mana pool, he's got to be careful with anyway. And he's 240 to his combination, the hook into the dismember. Forever's in very, very close, however. Clockwork, no hookshot available, and then in snared. Keep him away, then hook him down. Dismember still hasn't been used yet. And Naga, well, locked in here. She does have that Naga sleep, and I think she's tempted to push it off right now. 7-1 charges into a corner, TPing out. They don't have enough damage to pick her off. At the same time, these familiars are actually killing off Mafia. It's like a blind hook there coming out from Febby. And Banhuan's going to chase him down. Turn. Don't let him backstab you. Oh, get back in range of the tower. Earn charge hook. Oh! It was very close to Ferev. That's a little bit too far away. Just a little bit. Facade is looking really good now. Level 8 for him. He's out of fine, 22 for 0. His familiars are really working overtime. It's this micro which we always expected was going to be strong in Korea, obviously. The home of Brood War. I'm going to find another one. Doombringer. Locked in position. He lit off his scorched earth the more we're getting BT's Pudge up. He could TP to any of these trees here. In fact, he's going to TP to the familiars instead. Oh, wow. This is just some... It's like the Beastmaster Hawk TPs you get out from Pudges. You just never know. Hawk, Rot, Dismember, Lich. If he threw the ulti, it would have done the stun, but it wouldn't have got his teammate out to safety. He was rotted and slowed up too much. Nature's Prophet, duke it around the tree line. Up, down. Invis, can't see him. Sentry ward. Now the attack comes out for Rev. He sprouts himself up so they cannot see him. TP's back out to safety. The dust will pop off here. And that was looking for the Rikimaru. Lich Alderman, split. Get out of there. Don't. Okay, up to the trees. Let them take it. Febby, feel a little bit more concerned about jumping back up again. But when you've got some extra help, Mafia with the double kill. FXO's got to retreat out. They lost that punch. And that's a big streak. 781 gold taken by Mafia just then. Familiars, we're going to take some of that back again. This Mafia, his attack, kind of nibbles on the back of a familiar. Yeah, but those moments when the Lich ulti goes off, you get a lot of bounces just between the two heroes here and here. Just have that go back and forward. Finally, their luck happened when the trees came in close enough and the Lich ulti bounced off that direction. Then you get a little bit more space, but the damage was done by then. It's like the familiars trying to make a little bit more trouble for themselves. Taking a lot of damage while they do this. They do, of course, still pump out a lot of damage, but they don't have their stomps available to give them their life back again yet. Nature's Prophet now finishing up Treads, running Hand of Mice to start with as well. Not too shabby for him. Timing's okay. 47 for 12. Of course, you kind of hope it is. But then again, when he's 0 for 3, it's a little bit more problematic. Here in Clockwork, where the hell did he just hookshot to? Nowhere. I thought it was bottom lane, but I was like, well, there's no other place for him to be initiating to. He didn't hit the Prophet. And now Fabi's going to be pushing up the mid. It's a real confident build to do this kind of thing when you go BT's level 1. Dire's middle tower is under attack. Especially when you're already on the front lines. That's why most Pudges like to afford a 4-star. Or most recent option, which you can now get, is the Blink Dagger or Dragon Tail Stump. Put out the Sprout, throws the ulti as well for Rev. You've got to hit the Vision on him, and there's your hook. Kill secured. And also a Tier 2 tower going to go the way here of FXO. It's going to be a very quick push into that Tier 2 tower. And now they look to go in deeper. Tier 3 tower. Oh, the dragon form up and running. It's only a fresh one, too. Army of trees behind him. Yeah, they can go high ground. Because what's your counter push? The biggest weakness of a lich is the fact you can push against him. And there's nothing you can do to stop it. And now, Pudge. Oh, that is just one good thing for him. Oh, you've got the vision. Familiar's Urn Charge will pick him off. Burn off a little bit more of his mana. Lich Oldie's been used up here on the top lane, but looks like the creep wave managed to take up most of it. That poison tick is still working on the tower, and they found for Rev. Breathe fire as well. Familiar's drop down. Lich, one more attack. Urn Charge. Don't even need the proper attack. This will be top racks. This may even possibly be a very quick GG, and Pudge looking for it. Got him. Got him. Got him. One dupe. Oh, Femi's gonna kill himself. Oh, he can't turn the rod off. He can't turn the rod off. Oh, he denies himself. GG. 14:35. He had no control over that whatsoever. It was either the luck of the rot. It was the luck of the rot. The GG. Pudge carrying FXO to a quick victory over MVP, meaning that we go in for a third matchup between FXO as well as MVP. Now, that's the FXO I was kind of hoping to see. These guys going up against Alliance and DK later on. Well, I would say this month, but we're not in November yet. But in November, they'll be playing that one in the Nexon Invitational. And right now, though, this is going to be wrapping up this second game. We'll go to another short break. There will be a very, very short break. Not much more apart from that. And we'll be back here with game number 3, FXO up against MVP.